Hi everyone. Okay, let us start with this cancer series which I have already started for you. As a revision part, I'm going to revise a very interesting topic today, that is CA breast. So before your exams, all the interesting topics, all the important cancers, my plan is to revise with you. Okay, so let us start with the today's session. Yeah, Rudra. Yeah, you can ask your question, Rudra. Hello, Aaron. Yeah, hello. Okay, so let us start with a very important topic. Yes, that is CA breast. Why it is new? Because it is the topic which has seen a lot of developments, lot of changes. Every year the treatment protocol is just advanced. Every year, year by year, we are getting a advanced version of treatment for them. Yeah, Rudra, I'm waiting for your question, beta. Yes, and then we can start. So when we talk about CA breast, let us understand some basic miscellaneous things. Miscellaneous. You get lot of questions on CA breast, and you get lot of miscellaneous small single liners or one liners question also. So most common type. If you talk about the most common type overall, so most common type overall on the basis of pathology, yeah, tell me, on the basis of epidemiology also, on the basis of pathology also, tell me. So on the basis of epidemiology, we have sporadic type as the most common type, sporadic type. On the basis of epidemiology, it is sporadic. On the basis of pathology, if you talk about, it is invasive ductal CA. Invasive ductal CA. Can you tell me what variety of invasive ductal CA is the most common? Yes, it is NOS type. What do you mean by NOS type? Not otherwise specified. On the basis of location, if you talk about, let us take this to be a breast, this to be a central quadrant, yes, and then these are the four quadrants. The upper outer quadrant, yes, upper outer quadrant, it is 55 to 60% of the cases. So 55 to 60% of the cases, it is the upper outer quadrant. And if you talk about the least common, yes, it is the inner lower quadrant. 5 to 6% of them are seen in inner lower quadrant. Now some more miss one liners on the basis of prognosis. Yes, so let us see prognosis. Which one is having the best prognosis, which is having the worst prognosis? Let us see prognosis. If you see the best prognosis is by what is of invasive tubular CA. Remember, this is associated with the best prognosis. And if you talk about worst prognosis, it is lactating cancer. What do you mean by lactating cancer? It is another term for inflammatory cancer. So we have inflammatory cancer, which mimics like what? Mastitis. And then we have metaplastic cancer. What is so special about metaplastic cancer? That metaplastic cancer, the profile is basal type. Now what is this basal type? Yes. Again, when we talk about prognosis, I'll come back to this and I'll relate this also. If we talk about the prognosis, we have prognosis based upon the molecular markers. So prognosis based on molecular markers, if we talk about. What are the four standard molecular markers? Yes. We have ER, we have PR, we have HER2NEW, and we have KI67. They are the four standard. We have lot many other markers also, like Claudin, etc., but they are not that important. So if you talk about marker base, we have luminal A. I hope most of you know that luminal A is a variant where ER is positive, PR is positive, HER2NEW is negative, and KI67 is less than 14-15%. That is, it is not that aggressive. KI67 is a marker of aggressiveness. And therefore, always remember, this is associated with best prognosis. Best prognosis. We have luminal B also. We have luminal B also, where same profile is there, but it is associated with more aggressive nature. Why? Because KI67 is not elevated. Then you have HER2NEW enriched. You have HER2NEW enriched. If you talk about HER2NEW enriched, it is ER negative, PR negative, HER2NEW positive, and here hardly it makes any difference whatever is the KI67. And the worst prognosis is of basal type. Basal type. Why it is basal type? It is ER, PR, HER2NEW negative. So there is no scope of any immunotherapy, or you can say hormone therapy. Remember, this is associated with worst prognosis. Worst prognosis. You should not confuse this with triple negative. Try to understand that basal type and triple negative, they look alike. Yes or no? But what is the difference? The origin is the difference. ER, PR, HER2NEW from ductal origin will be known as a triple negative tumor. ER, PR, HER2NEW of myoepithelial origin will be known as a basal type. So simply by saying triple negative doesn't mean that it is a basal type. Yeah. Oh God, the first interval. Okay. Let us move forward. So worst prognosis, best prognosis we have seen. The next, we get questions on prognostic factors. Let us quickly revise prognostic factors also for CA breast. If you talk about prognostic factor, most important tumor related for both of them, answer is lymph node status. So most important prognostic factor overall or tumor related is the lymph node status. Again, most important in a metastatic disease, in a metastatic CA. Now you know, I know, everyone knows that if the tumor is metastatic, we only have one scope, and that scope is palliative chemotherapy. So on background of that, if the patient is ERPR negative, ERPR positive, we have a scope of adding antiestrogens or maybe SERMs. So a patient who is having a metastatic cancer with ERPR positive, along with chemotherapy, you can give hormone therapy. So there, the life span or the living expectancy is slightly better than those who are ERPR negative patients. So for metastatic cancers, yes, it is ERPR status which is the most important prognostic factor. When you talk about prognostic factor, patient related prognostic factor, answer is the age of the bleeding. The age is the most important. Let us quickly move forward. Let us talk about spread also. These are all miscellaneous which are very, 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 very important. So when we talk about spread, you should know two important things. The route of spread, the route of the spread, and the site of spread. The route of the spread and the site of spread. The most common route of spread, answer is always lymphatics for CA breast, and the site is axilla. Now when you talk about distant mets, the route is always going to be hematogenous. This is applicable everywhere in every tumor. All the distant metastasis happens because of hematogenous route only, because ultimately lymphatic will drain into the blood. Again, the answer is, where do we get to see? Yes, you get to see bones, lungs, yes, bones, lungs, liver, brain. Bones are a very frequent site, and bones, if you talk about, we get to see osteolytic most common than osteoblastic. So osteolytic more common than blastic. And if you, can you tell me what is the order? Yes. ओह, रुद्रदास सर 10th में हूँ, बोर्ड की तैयारी कैसे बड़ा. ओके ओके, आई जस्ट कुडेंट सी योर क्वेश्चन. हाँ, ओके ओके ओके. नेक्स्ट इज व्हाट अबाउट द ऑर्डर ऑफ द बोन्स? लंबर वर्टिब्रा, लंबर वर्टिब्रा, ग्रेटर देन फीमर, ग्रेटर देन थोरेसिक वर्टिब्रा, ग्रेटर देन यस योर रिब्स, ग्रेटर देन योर स्कल. दिस इज द ऑर्डर, दिस इज द ऑर्डर. यस. नेक्स्ट इज लेट अस टॉक अबाउट द रिस्क फैक्टर्स. लेट अस टॉक अबाउट द रिस्क फैक्टर्स. आई एम गोइंग टू रिवाइज एवरीथिंग एज फार एज सी ए ब्रेस्ट इज कंसर्न, बट इन अ नटशेल, इन अ नटशेल. यूजली आई टेक ऑन अन अकेडमी प्लस प्लेटफॉर्म, आई टेक इट फॉर एटलीस्ट फोर फोर एंड हाफ आवर्स, बिकॉज सी ए ब्रेस्ट इज अ बिग यूज टॉपिक, बट हेयर आई विल हैव अ क्विक रिविजन. या सो वेन यू टॉक अबाउट द रिस्क फैक्टर्स, वी हैव थ्री कैटेगरी ऑफ रिस्क फैक्टर्स. वन विच आर नॉन मॉडिफाइबल, विच आर नॉन मॉडिफाइबल. One risk factor category which can be modified, and a risk factor category which is histological. Histological. Yes. So, what are the non-modifiable risk factors? What are the non-modifiable risk factors? We have age. The risk increases it with age. The prognosis also betters with age. Again, do you know, students? It is the ड्यूरेशन ऑफ एक्सपोजर ऑफ बॉडी टू द ईस्ट्रोजन सर्ज, दैट इज वाई अर्ली मेनार्के एंड लेट मेनोपॉज आर वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट. सो अर्ली मेनार्के एंड लेट मेनोपॉज, अर्ली मेनार्के एंड लेट मेनोपॉज, दे आर अगेन इंपॉर्टेंट. अपार्ट फ्रॉम दैट वी हैव फैमिली हिस्ट्री. यस, फैमिली हिस्ट्री. यू हैव ब्राका म्यूटेशंस, यू हैव ब्राका म्यूटेशंस. यस. Apart from that, all those radiations. So there are a few important risk factors which are non-modifiable. If you talk about modifiable, nowadays obesity is being recognized as a very important. Then tobacco. So we have obesity, we have tobacco, we have sedentary lifestyle. Sedentary lifestyle. Yes. What else? You have lack of breastfeeding. Lack of breastfeeding, yes. What else? Alcohol. Alcohol. Alcohol is known to cause what? Mutation at the genetic level. Yeah. So tobacco, though, why oral cancers are so frequent with the combination of tobacco and alcohol? Tobacco causes the damage to the endothelium. Alcohol causes that mutation at the genetic level. You know, the first step is methylation. That is what. Next is, there is a very important risk factor which is HRT. Remember, OCP, as far as OCP is concerned, the new generation OCPs, the new generation OCPs, yes, the new generation OCPs, the risk is unknown. There is no clear consensus that it causes or it not. But yes, as far as the logic is concerned, they are having a very low dose of estrogen. And that is why they are not associated with any additional risk, but still the data is unknown. But HRT definitely. So if you have to mark anything, you will say OCPs are not associated with. So there is no clear cut evidences, but still the studies are going on. Now the next and the very important and the latest is, yes, the latest one is night shift working females. Night shift working females. Now, why this night shift workers? Do you know, estrogen is important, but more important is the surge or the peak of the estrogen. There was a study which was showing that the estrogen level, the midnight estrogen level, this is the 3 a.m. level in females who were asleep versus the females who were working was a bit different. Yes or no? And this peak is actually a trigger. This is a trigger. So this is a trigger. So night shift workers, it is now proven that this peak is a trigger for carcinogenesis. Yes or no? So Yes, we are not nocturnal. We don't have a nocturnal lifestyle. If we think that we'll wake up for late hours, definitely we'll ruin our health. And this is a big example of this. Okay, now what about the histological risk factors? Yes, we have some important histological risk factors like atypical ductal hyperplasia, atypical lobular hyperplasia. It has been asked how many times? 4 to 7 times increased risk. Yes. Yes, beta. Yes, Ashish. They are the side factors influencing. Again, the next is, have you heard of this term florid epitheliosis? Florid epitheliosis is again a very important risk factor. 1.9 times increased risk. One more is LCIS. Now, one student is a bit annoyed. Sir, you are writing LCIS as a risk factor. Try to understand that LCIS is itself a cancer. Let me tell you that logic behind this LCIS. There are a lot of students who have a lot of confusion in LCIS, or why LCIS has been included in this and that. Let us see. If you talk about in situ tumor, what is so unique about any in situ tumor? The unique feature about any in situ tumor is the basement membrane. Since these tumors are surrounded by basement membrane, there is no concept of spread. Since there is no concept of spread, there is no logic behind operating them. Yes or no? Ideally, the logic says, bhai, if spread hi nahi hoga, to usko operate karne ka fayda kya? There is no logic behind operating. Then why are we so insisting on operating these in situ tumors? The answer behind that is, today it is confined within basement membrane, but no one can guarantee the future. Like if you talk about DCIS, DCIS will definitely have a risk of conversion into what? Invasive ductal cancer? Yes or no? Now the question is, what population will have this converted into invasive ductal? Roughly the idea is 25% to 60% patients will get it converted into what? Invasive ductal. Yes, that is a fairly high number. And in what span of time? 5 to 15 years. So within 5 to 15 years, 25 to 60% of them will convert into invasive ductal, and that is why we always operate DCIS as soon as the diagnosis is made. Otherwise, if someone would have guaranteed ki nahi ye basement membrane ko cross nahi karega, you would have never gone. So try to understand, what about the data for LCIS? LCIS also carries a risk of conversion into invasive ductal more than invasive lobular cancer. Now the next question is, what population is at risk? Answer is, only 5 to 15% patients will get it converted. So that is a fairly less number. And the second logic that you have to remember is, this is a slow growing tumor. So over 15 to 25 years, these patients, only 5% to 15% patients will have. And to your knowledge, you should know, more than 2/3 of the females who are diagnosed with what? LCIS, they are perimenopausal. They are perimenopausal. Students, that means that you don't guarantee that cancer will happen. Yes. Today, if she is around 50, by the time she will develop cancer, she will be around 70-75. Do you know what is the concept of oncosurgery? Oncosurgery is any surgery done with an intention to prolong the life expectancy. Are you getting this? But say the upper limit of life expectancy is 75 years. So that is the reason that in elderly there is no concept of oncosurgery, because the medical comorbidities at the age of 70-75 years are so much that your cancer related risk for surgery is minimized. Yeah. So you cannot prolong the life expectancy even after doing a cancer surgery at that age. Therefore, nowadays it has been seen. And one more thing, that LCIS are mostly bilateral. LCIS are mostly bilateral. So if you have to do a surgery, you will do a what? Bilateral mastectomy. Today, that is the reason that we have developed a consensus that LCIS doesn't need to be operated. What we can do? we can keep an eye. And what is that eye? Active surveillance. Active surveillance. How you do this active surveillance? We do it by annual MRI. Annual MRI. You see that the tumor is changing the nature. You operate. Is that clear? So you can do active surveillance. Someone says, no sir, no sir, I want to reduce this risk further. I want to reduce this risk further. How you can do this? You can go for a chemo prevention. Chemo prevention. Yes or no? So with chemo prevention, using drugs like anastrozole or using drugs like tamoxifen, you can further reduce the risk. Today, surgery is not an active treatment option for LCIS, and that is the reason why TLCIS has been removed now, because LCIS is no more considered as an active modality to undergo treatment. Today we have an option of active surveillance and chemo prevention, taking in view that LCIS is a slow growing tumor, and we can observe that tumor. If we see that it is changing its nature to an invasive cancer, you always have an option of surgery. So LCIS is like, look at na, LCIS is no more considered as a cancer. No, bache, lion is lion. The difference between an invasive and in situ cancer is a lion in zoo versus lion in a wildlife reserve. Is that clear? Or a jungle. So LCIS, they give you a guarantee, nahi, theek hai, hum bahut slow growing hai, we will not actively get converted into invasive. And that is why you can give a chance to the lady by not going what for surgery. Is that clear to everyone? Yes. Let us move forward. Now, when we talk about the cancers, let us talk about a very important thing, that is the staging. Let us talk about the staging. When we talk about staging, yes. We will see the TNM staging. This is very, 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 very important. TNM staging. And we will see the AJCC 8th version. Yeah. So when we talk about AJCC 8, what is new? That TLCIS has been removed. Students, there is no terminology like TLCIS. Today, we have T-PEGETs. We have T-DCIS, and along with that we have T1. What is T1? Any tumor less than equal to 2 cm. We have T2, which is more than 2 up to 5 cm. We have T3, which is more than 5 cm. We have T4. This is any size. T4 is any size with T4A. What is T4A? Yes, into chest wall. Now there are a lot of things that are included and excluded in this category. Remember, invasion of pectoralis major. Pectoralis major is the muscle on which the breast is resting. Yeah. So the pectoralis major invasion is not included in this. Always remember, this is not an option. Next is, what is T4B? T4B is into skin. Now there are again lot of things to be remembered. Yes, what it includes? Come on students, tell me what it includes. It includes only three things. What are they? The first is the presence of satellite nodules. The second is the presence of ulcer. If the word ulcer is given, if the word satellite nodule is given, very good staffy beta. The third is presence of edema, or edema is also referred as PUD orange. I hope you know why this happens, because of the invasion of dermal lymphatics with the tumor cells. Yes. The next is, let us talk about the N. N1 is defined as free, or you can say freely mobile level 1, level 2 axillary lymph nodes. So freely mobile level 1, level 2 axillary lymph nodes. This is one. Next is, what is N2? N2, if you talk about, it is N2A. The freely mobile axillary lymph nodes now becomes what? Fixed. So fixed level 1, level 2 axillary lymph nodes. This is important. Fixed level 1, level 2 axillary lymph nodes. N2B. Yes. It is presence of ipsilateral internal memory. Students' internal memories are not palpable. They are detected on the radiology, maybe MRI, maybe mammography, maybe ultrasound. Internal memory, if it is present, it is designated as N2B. Then we have N3. What is N3, students? N3A is ipsilateral, level 3 lymph nodes. Yeah, so ipsilateral infraclavicular lymph nodes. N3B, when do we say N3B? In case if ipsilateral internal memory is also present, internal memory lymph node is also present, and along with that, students, you have axillary lymph nodes also. So axillary level 1, level 2 lymph nodes and internal memory, or maybe level 3 also. If it is present, then we say N3B. What is N3C? N3C is defined as presence of ipsilateral level, ipsilateral supraclavicular lymph nodes. Supraclavicular lymph nodes. So N staging, T staging, everything is really very, 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 very important. Now let us go to the management part. Let us go to the treatment part or the management part. When you talk about CA breast, we have to remember that there are two types of cancer. One is the in situ cancer and one is the invasive cancer. One is in situ and one is invasive. Now, what are the in situ cancers? Yes, we have LCIS. I have already taught you, and we have a DCIS. I have taught you that there is a fairly good increased risk for cancer in them, conversion into invasive cancer, and that is why they are actually requiring treatment. Yes. So if we talk about DCIS, everyone knows that this is a tumor which is confined in the what? Basement membrane. Yes. So the standard of the management, is a BCS. What is BCS? What do you mean by BCS? Yes, breast conservation surgery. So just removal, wide local excision of the tumor is known as BCS. So breast conservation surgery is the ideal management. Someone said, no, sir, when you are doing a breast conservation surgery, there could be a possibility that there is a residue. So you have done a breast conservation surgery and there is a residue. How to approach this patient? So post BCS, if there is residual mass, then what to do? Nothing to worry, students. Nothing to worry. To this breast conservation surgery, add radiotherapy. Now try to understand that there could be tumors which are multifocal. Yes or no? So there is a tumor here also, there's a tumor here also, there's a hair tumor here also. So instead of doing multiple lumpectomies, you can straightforward go for a mastectomy. Remember, the treatment is not MRM. Try to understand, the treatment is not MRM. Why? Because MRM is defined as any mastectomy where the lymph node dissection is done. The treatment is simple mastectomy. What is not done? Important. There is no role of axillary lymph nodal dissection and also chemotherapy. Why there is no role of chemotherapy and axillary nodal dissection? Because you know that this is in situ tumor, and in situ tumor have no concept of spread. If there is no concept of spread, then how will the axillary nodes get affected? That is why we don't give for axillary lymph nodes. Since there is no question for hematogenous spread, there is no point of giving chemotherapeutic agents to these patients. Are you getting this or no? Next is, if we talk about invasive cancer, is this clear to everyone? Is this clear? In this, we have lot of new questions which are asked. Like you get a question on Van Nuys score, you get a question on Nottingham's prognostic index. So Van Nuys score, if you talk about, is a way how the British Council of Surgeons, actually the British Council of Surgeons, they have their own way of evaluating a DCIS. Once you do mastectomy, once you do a lumpectomy, you send that sample, they see the tumor size, they see the tumor margins, they see the grade and the necrosis, and also they are including the presence and absence of microcalcifications and age. Based on that, they are giving a score. They are giving a score from 3. So 3, 4 and 5. If it is 3 and 4, they say ki, okay, you don't need any extra treatment, BCS is sufficient. 5, 6 and 7. If it is 5, 6 and 7, they say to add radiotherapy, and if it is 8 and 9, they say go for mastectomy. So American Breast Association doesn't follow this, and that is why it's a controversy. So Van Nuys score, there was only one question, that what is not included, ERPR status is not a part of this Van Nuys score. Again, let us talk about this invasive cancer also. If we talk about invasive cancer, invasive cancer is further divided into early breast cancer. What do you mean by early breast cancer? T1 to T2, N0 to N1, and M should be 0. This is what is early breast cancer. Remember, second is LABC. What do you mean by LABC? Locally advanced breast cancer. So this is early breast cancer. This is locally advanced breast cancer. Locally advanced breast cancer. If you talk about locally advanced breast cancer, what is this? T4, N0, M0, T3, N1, M0, NET, if N is between 2 to 3, M0, that is what is known as your LABC, that is what is known as your LABC. So T4, N0, M0, T3, N1, M1. NET, N2 to N3. Important is there is a state which is known as T3, N0, M0. It has already been asked. Yes, it has already been asked in exams. T3, N0, M0 is a big tumor. Yes, but it is neither considered as early breast cancer by definition nor considered as LABC. Why it is not LABC? Because it has not advanced anywhere. It is N0, M0. How can you say it is LABC? Why it is not an early breast cancer? Because of the big size. Remember, whenever you do mastectomy, you have to elevate the skin flap and then only you can do the closure. This tumor is so big. If you try to see if this is a mass and these are the skin flaps that you have raised. After removing the tumor, you will not be able to close this, and that is why by definition it is neither LABC nor early breast cancer, but it is managed or treated like LABC. By definition it is not. How it is treated like LABC? The intention in LABC is always to downgrade. It is always to downgrade the size of the tumor and then we go for. I'll discuss this again, don't worry. Then we talk about the third is advanced breast cancer. If you talk about advanced breast cancer, it is defined as NET, NEN, and it should be M, it should be 1. NET, NEN, M should be 1. NET, NEN, N should be 1. Let us move forward. Let us see two, three important things about this. When we talk about early breast cancer, yes, what is the concept of early breast cancer? The management part I'm talking about, the management part. The management is in two phase. The treatment is in two phase. The first phase is the phase where the patient will undergo surgery, and the second phase is the phase where we carry the post-surgery management. Post-surgery management, where you give chemotherapy, radiotherapy, hormone therapy, depending upon whether the indications are there or not. This phase 2 is more or less common for all. Let us talk about the surgery. If you talk about the surgery for early breast cancer, you have two options. You always give two options to the patient. One is the concept of MRM. Another is the concept of BCT. Now what is BCS? We have seen breast conservation surgery. What is the concept of BCT? let us see this also. Let us understand the concept of BCT also. BCT is a breast conservation surgery, is a breast conservation surgery where two things are done. Radiotherapy is must, you have to do this, and where sentinel lymph node biopsy is done. So sentinel lymph node biopsy and radiotherapy is must. This is very, 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 very important. Now, if you talk about the concept of MRN, I hope you know, you are going to go for removal of breast. Not only this removal of breast, along with that, you will go for axillary lymph nodal dissection. Now, two questions you get on axillary lymph nodal dissection also. What are the boundaries of the axillary lymph nodal dissection? So try to understand, this is the axillary vein. The axillary vein forms the upper boundary. Yes. Then we have thoracodorsal pedicle, which is supplying the latissimus dorsi. So this is thoracodorsal pedicle. Thoracodorsal pedicle, this is going to form the lateral boundary. If this is not given in the option, this is the skin. Here you have a muscle. Which is known as latissimus dorsi. This is going to form the lower boundary. Remember, if this is not given in the option, we have a vein here. What is that vein? Angular vein is forming the, again, the lower boundary. And in the medial side, yes, you have the chest wall. So ribs, these are the ribs which are forming the medial boundary. And here you have the coracoacromion ligament, or you can say Halsted ligament. So you have Halsted ligament, and this is, students, the place where you are going to do the lymphatic dissections, and minimum 10 lymph nodes should be harvested. So this is very, 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 very important. Now, if you talk about the concept of BCT, It's very simple. How do you do this BCT? This is very easy and simple. Suppose this is the lump. Here you have a dual approach. What is the first approach? What is the first thing that you do? The first thing that you are going to do is you are going to do a lumpectomy. Yes, this is the lumpectomy. You are going to remove the lump. Now, since you also have to do, you have to do a lymphatic examination, you will first inject the dye. So if this is the nipple areolar complex, there is injection of dye, and where is the dye injected? It is intradermal. All these questions are important. Yes, intradermal injection of dye. What are the two standard agents? Either sulfur colloid, that is technetium 99 sulfur colloid, or you can go for a methylene blue, depends upon whatever, what probe you are using. So either you can use technetium 99 sulfur colloid, or you can use a simple methylene blue. Remember, you wait for 20-25 minutes. Actually, that is the reason why you inject the dye first. This gives you 20-25 minutes, and then you make a second incision in the hairless crease of the axilla. And then you will inspect for the stained lymph nodes. Yes, more than two or two stained lymph nodes, or if you are, in case you are using technetium 99 sulfur, so in that case you will use a gamma camera. So more than 10% uptake on the gamma camera, these two are considered significant, and if this is present, this is an indication that you go for axillary lymph node dissection via same incision. You will do an axillary dissection. This is about BCT. I'll also show you one image how the BCT is done, so you'll have a better idea how this BCT. So I'm doing this BCS for a lady. So try to see this. This is a lump along which I have made one incision. What is the difference in this BCS? You are conserving the breast, so I'm not excising the breast, I'm conserving the breast. Just see, I have marked the margins, and along the ink margins, I am removing this. The next thing is to raise the skin flap. So you have to be very gentle, and you have to raise the skin flap. You have to separate the skin and the tumor away. This is a very important thing because this is a time when you make the skin flaps too narrow, too thin. The ideal thickness should be 7 mm. If you make it too thick, it will get necros. And if you make too thick, yes, you will leave the residue. So yes, with a monopolar electrosurgical instrument, you can do this. And let me just move forward. Whenever you are dealing with a tumor, you come across a lot of blood vessels. Remember, this is a harmonic scalpel focus. This is a harmonic focus which I am using. And always the oncosurgical dissection should be bloodless so that you don't get, you get a proper vision of the field, what you are doing. So if you see, these are new generation instruments, but yes, they make the surgery really wonderful. So you can see a bloodless surgery is going on. So let us quickly move forward. And yes, since you are dealing with a tumor, it will be associated with lot of neovascularization, and you have to be, there may be scarring also along the tissue. So you have to be very gentle, but yes, at that same time, you have to think, you have to be prepared about the hemostasis also. So can you see all the way the tumor, we have gone right up to the pectoralis. Yes, this is the pectoral fascia. Can you see that glistening white yellow tissue? This is the pectoral fascia, which now from where I am just lifting the tumor. So just wait. Okay. Just wait. Yes. I'll just quickly go forward. Move forward. So just I'm lifting the complete tumor. This is the last leg of dissection. Yes, the tumor is gone. Done. So can you see the tumor has been removed? This is a big tumor. This is a tumor which has been removed. And now what you do, you wash the cavity and you always mark the cavity from where you have done this surgery. Yes, you always mark the cavity. How you mark the cavity? Like I will take a Johnson & Johnson open clip applicator and I will mark it. Just see, I will place the pins. Why I will place the pins? So that in case if there is any recurrence, if there is any residue, we can come to know that this was the plane. So in all the four quadrants, 12 o'clock, 3 o'clock, 6 o'clock, 9 o'clock, I'm going to place the pin. So this is an open clip applicator with which I will place the clip. And this is my guide in future. Whenever I screen this lady with radio raw, can you see this is the pectoralis which has been cleared off. So this is the pectoralis major which has been cleared of the tumor. And in this case, there was infiltration of the pectoralis minor also, for which, yes, see, just see, I'm holding pectoralis minor. And why it was cut? Because it was involved. So pectoralis minor had to be cut. And then you can see axillary, what are the boundaries of dissection? I will show you. Here there is, if you talk about axillary dissection, angular, this is the axillary vein. Here this is the thoracodorsal vein. Here angular vein. And here this is the chest wall. This is your boundary of axillary dissection. This is, so since this is a revision class, I'll not go in lot of depth. I'll quickly come back to this. Let us see the post-surgery management. I hope now BCT, BCS and MRM, they are clear to you. When we talk about post-surgery management, very quickly, in a nutshell, I'll discuss it with you. Post-surgery, either we have to go for chemotherapy, or we have to add it with radiotherapy, or we have to go for hormone therapy. These are the three options. I'm going to ask you, will we go for chemotherapy? The indication is any tumor with size more than equal to 1 centimeter, or any tumor with size more than equal to 0.5 centimeter with lymph nodes positive or with high risk group. So if the patient belongs to high risk group, even if the size is more than 5 or 5 mm, you go for chemotherapy. What is the regimen of chemotherapy? The regimens are, there are 3 drug regimen versus 2 drug regimen. Lot of regimens are there, 3 drug versus 2 drug regimen, of which 2 drug is more popular nowadays. We have doxorubicin followed by yes, paclitaxel or docetaxel. So pacli or docetaxel, this is the most popular nowadays. 4 into 4 cycles, 4 cycles of each. this is the most popular. Otherwise, there are lot of regimens. When we talk about the radiotherapy part, the question is, who is requiring? Indication is all T4, or you can say all LABC patients. All LABC patients require radiotherapy. Second is early breast cancer. All early breast cancer, no. Early breast cancer who have opted for BCT. Second is, if the tumor free margin, generally we spare a good margin, but if the tumor free margin is found to be less than 2 mm, yes, it is an indication for adding radiation. The third is, if 4 or more lymph nodes are found to be positive. And the fourth is, in case of relapse. So this is the place where you will go for radiotherapy, students. Again, try to understand what is the regimen of radiotherapy. Answer is, you can go for 50 to 60 grays. 50 to 60 grays, generally 50 grays is preferred. 50 to 60 grays in 6 weeks, and that too divided doses. So generally 50 grays is preferred. 50 grays is preferred and divided weekly doses. Yes, we also have an option of APBI. What is APBI? This is a form of brachytherapy. So APBI is defined as accelerated partial breast irradiation. Accelerated partial breast irradiation. What is the concept of this APBI? Let us see. So this is a brachytherapy. This is a brachytherapy where instead of radiating the complete breast, you are going to radiate only the cavity from which you have taken out the tumor. And this is what is the USP of this. So since you are not radiating the complete therapy, complete breast, this is known as partial breast radiation. Why accelerated? Because instead of 50 to 60 grays, you give 34 grays over 5 days, and that too twice a day. So within 5 days post surgery, your therapy is also completed. But this is not for all, and this is again very, 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 very important. What is the standard inclusion criteria? What is the standard inclusion criteria for ABPI? The answer is, first of all, the age of the lady should be on the higher end, 50 to 60 years, not less than 50 years at least. The tumor size should be less than equal to 2 centimeters. That means it is only for T1 tumors. Third is, the pathology should be ductal, because the lobular pathology tends to be multifocal and bilateral. So ductal pathology should be there. Again, the lymph nodes should be negative. Axillary lymph nodes should not be present. The tumor free margin, should be more than 2 mm. And this should be important is post BCS status. It is only for BCS. So post BCS status with all of them. It's not one of them. It's all of them. All of them should be there. Then only. So this is very, 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 very important. Very important. Let us move forward. And quickly talk about the hormone therapy also. If you talk about hormone therapy, in case you are ER/PR positive, yes, you have to start with hormone therapy. Now the therapy depends upon the age. Yes, if you are pre or if you are perimenopausal, students, in that case, you have to start with SERM. And you know, the only option that is preferred is tamoxifen. In case if you have attained menopause, the better option for you is always and always anastrozole, or you can say aromatase inhibitors. As far as the comparison between them is concerned, aromatase inhibitors as like anastrozole, letrozole, exemestane, etc., they have 40% decreased risk of contralateral CA breast. Next is, if it is HER2 new, yes, you have to go for trastuzumab or Herceptin. Trastuzumab is given for 1 year. Remember, if you have shown no response, then you can add pertuzumab, or there are new drugs. Now these two drugs, what is the duration for aromatase inhibitors? 10 years. Yes, so this was a basic overview. Now we will discuss about the LABC also. We have almost finished everything. When we talk about LABC, when we talk about LABC, the management is a bit different. Yeah, what is the management? How the management is different? Try to understand. The first phase is not surgery. The first phase is NACT. The aim behind NACT is to downgrade the tumor. Yes. The second phase is your surgery, and the only surgery which is done for them is MRM. BCT is not an option for them. And the third phase is chemo, radio, plus minus hormone therapy. This depends upon whether they are positive or not. So almost we have done everything. The last heading that we put is advanced CA breast. If you talk about, yes, the management is palliative chemotherapy. You might choose to give hormone therapy in case if ERP are positive, and that is what is the beauty. That is why we say ERP are positive are the most important prognostic factor. Remember, what is the indication for surgery? The only indication for surgery, students, the only indication is if there is an ulcerative fungative growth. In that case only you will go for the surgery. And what is the surgery that we do? We do a simple mastectomy. Now people come up with a word that breast toileting or toilet mastectomy. Student, toilet mastectomy is the word not to be used. It is highly discouraged or condemned. Breast toileting, the idea behind toileting is to debride the breast of that unwanted ulcerative fungative growth. Because this is not therapeutic. This is not prognostic. It's only palliative. When you get that lady rid of that ulcerative fungative mass, the quality of life improves. Because there is a reason behind oncosurgery, any surgery done with an intention to prolong life expectancy. Remember, if you cannot add days to the patient's life, try to add colors to the patient's life. So whatever days are left, yes, she should be living with all the, you can say, she should be having the spending the best time of her life. Yes. So with this, I end the revision for this cancer of the breast. Again, I will be continuing with other cancers also. I will be notifying it to you and we'll be just revising it well. So I hope you enjoyed this session. Yes. And please do join my Telegram group. My Telegram group, the group is by the name of SX Dada. Yes, this is the link of my Telegram group. I keep on notifying. You can also subscribe to my YouTube channel. Yes, please join Unacademy using my code Dr. Dixit and avail the benefit of all the free classes. Or you can use the code Surgery Live also, Surgery Live. And you can get yourself a bit, you can say, one step ahead in your preparation. We conduct all the free sessions here, so you can join for the free sessions on Unacademy using this code. You just have to download the app, put the code and just join, and just you can feel the difference or that the change in your preparation. Okay, I hope you enjoyed. I enjoyed my best. So all the best.